Hey guys, we're in Psalm 124 today, and the handout is in the description. So do give that a click, print it off, get a few different colour highlighters because you're going to need a few. And then we'll get going. So, have you ever been in a totally hopeless situation? One where it seems like there's no way you can win? I have. In fact, I've got a recording of it. Let me show you now. So as you saw in our socially distanced tug of war, I was losing quite badly. I was being beaten quite badly by Sophie Anne, and it seemed like I was going to lose. But then my sister, my big sister Izzy, came in. She said she was on my side, and with Izzy on my side, I could get through the tug of war and win. If you want to rewind and have a laugh and have a look, you'll see Sophie Anne was completely thrashing me, like I was being destroyed. But just when it looked like it was all over, Izzy was on my side. And so I got through it. Now, that's just a silly little picture of what Psalm 124 is all about. Psalm 124 is a story of a hero being on the losing team's side, winning their battles for them. And in fact, this is obviously a story much greater than the silly little video I just shared with you. It's a story of God being on our side. And if God is on our side, then we will get through the difficulties of life. That's how we're going to get through the difficulties, because God is on our side. Now let's see if this psalm actually says that. So on to our first little heading. The Lord was on our side. Now there's a kind of history that both really annoys me, but also really interests me. According to my brother who studies history at university, it's called counterfactual history. It's essentially a history of what ifs. It's a kind of what if Hitler had won the war. That's the one that really interests me. Let me just tell you, according to some historians, they think it would have gone down something like this if Hitler had won the war. Germany would have controlled half of the world by now, and Japan, the Emperor of Japan, would have controlled the other half. A bit weird, isn't it? And even more weirdly, Canada would have been the only country in the world that wasn't occupied. It's the only free country. And even more bizarrely, the Mediterranean Sea would have been drained. So if all your nice sailing holidays to Greece would have been gone, I'm afraid. But anyway, let's have a read of Psalm 124, verses 1 to 5. I'll read this out for us. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel say, if the Lord had not been on our side when people attacked us, they would have swallowed us alive when their anger flared against us. The flood would have engulfed us. The torrent would have swept over us. The raging waters would have swept us away. So do you see that this verse 1 to 5 is what my brother would have called counterfactual history? It's the what if history. The psalmist is saying, imagine if the Lord hadn't been on our side, what would have happened then when people like attacked us? Now, for you guys, just have a read through the whole psalm, not just verse 1 to 5, but the whole psalm, and write down a list of the different pictures, the different metaphors, different word pictures that the psalmist uses to describe the threat that's against them. Okay. Brilliant. So let me just go through them from the top to the bottom. So the first one is in verse 3. You see, it says, swallowed us alive. It's a picture of an earthquake, of like the ground splitting and kind of there's a big chasm forming. And suddenly the people who were standing there have been swallowed alive and they fall into the depths. So that's the first picture of a big earthquake. The second picture in verses 4 and 5 is quite obvious, I think, like a flood and rushing waters and torrents. It's a picture of a flood, isn't it? Of someone standing somewhere and suddenly there's a flood that comes and it washes everything away. And then in verse 6, it says, torn by teeth. It's the picture of a lion attack. It's quite scary. You can kind of picture, maybe you've seen it in some film or something, but like lions are vicious. So this is verse 6, a picture of a lion attack. So we've had swallowed alive, as an earthquake, and then a flood, which is a flood. We've had a lion attack. And now the final one is slightly harder to see. In verse 7, it says a fowler's snare, which is a bit weird, isn't it? A fowler's snare, well, I had to look up what a fowler was. A fowler is just a bird hunter. So it's a fowler's snare is a trap that a bird hunter uses, and a bird will kind of fly in and land on the trap, and it'll catch the bird, and then the hunter will come along and kill the bird. So that last one is a kind of trap to be ready to kill the bird. So there are loads of ideas out there about what exactly David means by each of these pictures, each of these metaphors. But the basic point is this. Israel is facing serious, fatal danger. Maybe when he's talking about the floods, he's talking, he's kind of thinking back to the flood of Noah, when God protected his people through the really dangerous times. Or when he's talking about the hunter, maybe he's thinking back to his own life, David's own life, when he was hunted through the wilderness by his enemies. But whatever it is, thinking about the threats that they were facing, they were saying to each other, wow, imagine if the Lord hadn't been on our side through all of that. Then it would have been like there was an earthquake and then there was a split and we all fall down into the depths of the earth if the Lord wasn't on our side. Or a flood comes, like in Noah's day, and it washes us all away, so we will drown. As the rushing water comes, we wouldn't have been protected by the Lord if the Lord wasn't on our side, so we would have been swept away. Or, like we're facing a lion with no weapons or armour, it would have sunk its teeth deep into our flesh and we would have been killed, torn apart. Or like a hunter is out to get us and he lays a trap and we fly down into it. And then without the Lord, we wouldn't have escaped from the hunter's trap, we would have been killed. But all this is what my brother calls counterfactual history. It's what-if history. Because look at verse 6, have a look down. Verse 6 says, blessed be the Lord, that's praise be to the Lord, who has not let us be torn by their teeth. The whole point of the thought experiment, the whole point of the what-if history is that we haven't been swallowed alive. We didn't drown, we weren't torn apart. We weren't killed by the hunter, all because the Lord was on our side. That's how the psalmist explains how they have gotten this far in the journey. And so here, the psalmists are thinking, you know, how have we gotten this far in the journey? Well, the Lord's been on our side. The Lord was on their side. And just like we heard in Psalm 121, he was keeping them and he was watching over them. So if the Lord had been against them, they wouldn't have made it. There's no way. If God is against you, how can you make it? But because the Lord was on their side, they made it through. So we made it through. That's the next heading we're on. So they made it through, or we made it through. I want us to focus in a bit more on verse 6 and 7. So verse 6 starts with a command to praise the Lord. And the reason for praising him is just about to be explained, so listen closely. When I was younger, and I would ask my mum for something a little bit much, you know, like if I would ask for like more ice cream or something, or a really expensive toy, she'd say this to me. She'd say, do you want the long answer or the short answer? And I'd say either. And she'd say, well, the short answer is no. The long answer is no. And it's silly and it made me laugh when I was a kid. But that's essentially what we've got here in verse 6 and 7. Verse 6 is our short answer. The short answer is, the Lord has not let us be damaged. You see there the word let. He has not let us be damaged. He's not let us be torn apart. The short answer tells us that he has been in complete control the whole time, for all of the journey. And he's used his power and his control for us. He's on our side. He's used it to protect us and keep us. He's worked on our behalf so that the lion hasn't been allowed to tear us apart. That's the short answer. But the long answer is in verse 7. And it's actually essentially telling us the same thing. But it's telling us the same thing from a slightly different angle. So we're seeing more light, and we actually praise God even more because of it. So let me read verse 7 for us. We have escaped like a bird from the fowler's snare. The snare has been broken and we have escaped. So it's talking about a bird who's been caught in a trap. It's about to be killed. It's a picture of a hunter who's looking for a bird. And in the same way, there was someone looking to kill the psalmist. That's the point of the picture. Is the psalmist saying, look, in the same way, there was someone looking to kill me. And we don't know exactly who he was thinking of or what situation it was, but there was someone out to get him. And this is true for Christ too. All these psalms point to the Lord Jesus in some way. And this one is written by David, and Jesus called himself the greater David. He is the greater David. And as Satan longed to destroy Jesus, just as the hunter in this picture longs to destroy the bird. Do you remember Satan longed to destroy Jesus? Satan encouraged Judas to betray Jesus to the cross. And Jesus willingly fell into the hunter's trap because he knew. He went to the cross because he knew he was the only one who could break the hunter's snare. He knew he could break his weapon. So Christ died. And 3 days later, he defeated death by resurrecting, showing that the snare has been broken. Death has been swallowed up in victory because of our Lord Jesus. So we in Jesus can say confidently that the snare has been broken and we have escaped. Satan and death no longer hold any power over us anymore. His weapon, Satan's weapon, the trap of death, was broken by Christ. That's what we can say if we have faith in Jesus. Because the Lord was on our side when it mattered most, we have and we will make it through. Now, another little exercise for you guys, just grab your pencils, your pens, your different colour highlighters, and in one colour, highlight everything in the psalm, the whole psalm, that's in the past tense. So go through and look for everything that's written in the past tense. You know, we have been something, or, you know, all this stuff. And then find everything in the present tense. Well, I hope you've done that. It's really good if we kind of get really stuck into the passage. We understand so much more about God and his word when we think hard about it. If you look through verse 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it's all in the past tense, isn't it? There's a little bit at the beginning of verse 6, praise be to the Lord, that's in the present, but everything else in the past tense, isn't it? It's all in the past tense, apart from verse 8, our help is in the name of the Lord. Now, all the rest has been something which happened or could have happened in the past, like people attacked us, the flood engulfed us, we have escaped, the snare has been broken, all this stuff. But here, the perspective changes. We're out of the history books, and David now says, our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. David has been reflecting on how God has kept them in the past, has kept them safe, even when they were in like absolute mortal danger. And now he can say that he knows that his help is in the name of the Lord. Because the Lord has helped him through so much in the past, he can say certainly that the maker of heaven and earth, who created and sustains and controls and directs all things, is on their side. What a wonderful thing to be able to say with such certainty. The Lord is on my side. Can you say that? Can you say that the God who made all things is on your side? If you have faith in Jesus, if you trust what he has done on the cross, then you can say that. So wonderful. You can alleviate so much worry. It can take away so much anxiety. Because we know that the Lord is on our side. Now, how can we know if the Lord is on our side in the everyday troubles of life? In our kind of shameful sin? In the hurt that others bring to us? Or in different, in, you know, any difficult circumstances when things just don't go our way? Or even in extraordinarily difficult circumstances, the cancer in the family, abuse from others, deep pain that doesn't seem to have an end. how can we know then that God is on our side? Well, we can't just rely on our feelings, right? We cannot be waiting for a spiritual shiver down our spine to tell us that somehow God is for us. Emotions are good, and we are emotional creatures. God has made us that way. But emotions are not enough. They cannot be relied upon. Have a look at what David did in the psalm. He looked back on Israel's history. He saw Israel, himself included, couldn't have gotten through all of the dangers it faced without God on their side. So, how am I to know, how are you to know that the Lord is currently on my side, on your side? I am to look back in my life on the difficulty and sin that he has kept me through and see that he has been on my side. But that's not quite enough. For ultimate certainty that the Lord is on our side, like Psalm 124 tells us he is, we need to look further back than our own lives. We need to look back to a time when God proved that he was on the side of sinners, like you and me, by breaking the snare of death. And as we look back to the cross and resurrection, it will be the ultimate comfort and assurance for us that our God is for us, not against us, even if we are sinners and even if the situation is dire. Look at the cross and see how much God loved us, how much he is for us, how much he is on our side. Romans 8 says this, let me read this for us. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? It's amazing, isn't it? Our God is for us. He gave up his son for us. He was and he is on our side. And so we come to our last little heading, so we will make it through. No matter what lies ahead, our God is on our side every single step of the journey home. So there is no doubt in my mind that for those of us who belong to him, all of us who have that simple faith in Jesus and what he did for us on the cross, our God will fight for us until we arrive safely home with him. So, as we're going on the journey home, don't be discouraged or put down completely by the difficulties or troubles that we face. We need to think back to the cross, where Jesus showed us that God is on our side, even when we're against him. We know that we will make it through because the Lord is on our side.